Welcome to Ordinary People Doing Extraordinary Things, the podcast show. I'm your host, Carrie Roberts. And today I have another wonderful guest on, Ms. Kathleen O'Brien. Welcome, Kathleen. Excited to have you here.
Oh, I'm delighted to be here, Carrie. Thanks for asking me.
Yes. So I want to start off that an interesting fact that I read about you, which of course you obviously know, that you were once dubbed the most heard voice in America by the New York Times because you were the voice of the directory assistant throughout the 80s and 90s. So if anyone dialed 411 at the time from their landline, they would hear your voice. And I'm curious, because that was about maybe 30, 40 years ago.
Yeah.
When you think of, or if you've listened to those recordings of your voice from that time, what are maybe the first words that come to mind when you think of who you were then versus who you are now?
Boy, that is a great question. I was probably pretty ambitious. I saw my life as stretching out ahead of me with a lot of promise. I've always been pretty optimistic, so I think I felt good about everything that I was doing at the time. However, I will say that I didn't have the maturity I do now. I worried an awful lot about everything. And, you know, in that respect, it's quite different. Also, my voice has changed a lot. It was more mellifluous then, I think. It's a little scratchier now, but with that scratchiness comes great wisdom.
That is a very good answer. I love that. Okay. I'm in my mid-30s, and I was telling you before we got on that this idea of age is something I've been thinking about a lot. And then I was like, oh, I have Kathleen coming on. This is perfect. So first of all, I'm curious for you, was there a point in your adult life that you had a feeling of, oh, I feel like I'm old, or I feel like I'm getting old? And maybe what was like that age that maybe you first felt that?
Oh, I definitely remember it very well. In fact, that's when I started actually researching aging. I was just about to turn 60. And I didn't mind that personally. I felt good and I felt like I was pretty fit and still very curious and active. But I worried about the way society viewed older people. I think it was more societal than personal. And I thought, I'm going to have trouble living in a society that wants me to stay perpetually young. I don't know how I'm going to do that, because experience taught me that the years just keep adding up and you really can't go backward. And then I saw these things that, you know, the culture was telling me to do, like, well, you're going to need plastic surgery, you're going to need, you know, you're going to need teeth whitening, you're going to need a different kind of underwear, you're going to need... Yeah, I mean, just all the things they sell older people. And you might even need a sports car to prove you're still young. And I thought, I don't want to do any of these things. This is ridiculous. So I thought, you know, there has to be another way to age, rather than seeing it as this sort of unfortunate ride on the downslope, just going further and further toward the bottom, toward the end. There must be a different way of looking at it. And what I found, Carrie, is when I decided to go back and see how did other cultures view getting old? What is different about what ancient philosophers thought compared to what our culture thinks about aging now? And it was remarkable. It was almost radical. Ancient cultures thought that when you got old, that was the pinnacle of human achievement. That was it. That's what everybody was striving for. And then what I also found out is that cutting edge gerontology has a similar view of aging. They have left behind in a lot of ways this idea of anti-aging, that you need to stay young, look young, be young. if you really listen to some of the people in the forefront of gerontologic research, you will hear those messages. Well, it's just not getting through to the culture. I don't think people are hearing that. And certainly, I don't expect everyone to have gone back and reviewed what ancient philosophers had to say about growing old. But I just found it so interesting. And I was so heartened to think that, yes, I can grow old and feel good about it. And some of the best years still lie ahead.
Do you think it's different for women versus men?
Yeah, to a certain extent I do, but in a different way. I think the culture puts a lot of emphasis on appearance. Mm-hmm. Let's face it, we're an appearance-oriented culture. Whether you're your age, Carrie, or whether you're my age, people judge you almost immediately on how you look. It's very unfortunate, but it is sort of ingrained in us, at least in the West. So I think there is a lot of pressure on women who are aging to maintain this youthful appearance at all costs. For men, I think it's a little different. But I do think there is pressure on men to maintain this identity, to be productive into their later years, to be out there, to be busy, to be competing. And of course, women also have that kind of pressure too. But I think men have it more often than women. Men are reluctant sometimes to retire because they feel their whole identity is wrapped up in what they do for a living rather than who they are. And the idea of productivity in the Western culture, it more or less means contributing to the GDP. You know, you got to be out there, you still got to be making money, you got to be in the fray. And if you look at how ancient cultures viewed getting older, and particularly cultures today that were once ancient, I call them enduring cultures, Eastern cultures, African cultures, Native American cultures, they do not place that emphasis on that kind of productivity. Older people aren't supposed to be continuing to do that. Older people are supposed to be the wise ones of the mm-hmm. culture, the ones that help everyone slow down a little bit and take a broader look at what's going on. We're the ones people are supposed to come to for advice, and we're supposed to be honored for all these years we have lived. And how remarkably different that mindset is, Carrie, from the mindset our society, our culture exudes today.
Yeah, I mean, I would agree, you know, especially like you said, in the US, you know, when you talk to people from other countries who've never been here, and their perception of the US is the Kardashians, Las Vegas, LA, yeah. Disney, you're like, you know, and that's what our culture is putting out, you know, maybe externally. And even internally, you know, we're feeling it. You know, you're seeing things even now, I think more than ever on social media, obviously back then more in magazines, and this kind of idea of, again, I'm going to say more on women, of what you're supposed to look like, what you're supposed to be achieving, you know, this feeling, for young people, I think all the time, but especially in 20s where they feel like they have to have it figured out. I'm getting older. I'm not there. I'm not. And this idea of society putting pressure that you're supposed to be at a certain place at a certain age in your life. And when you're not there, that feeling of worry that you kind of talked about, mm-hmm. did you ever feel that? And if so, like, how did you kind of deal with that feeling?
Well, I did. And it was very hard to deal with at the time because you really don't have the perspective of an mm-hmm. older person when you're young. It's so easy to get caught up in expectations. And this culture has incredible expectations for young people. Well, why aren't you out there? Why aren't you moving along? Why aren't you getting promoted? Why don't you have a house? Aren't you going to have children? What are you doing with your career? I mean, it's all of these expectations that I have to say, as an older person looking back, seem almost frivolous. That's really the word that comes to mind, because ultimately, as you get older and you look at your life, the things you value are not these little milestones that you keep achieving. That isn't what is important. As you get older, you realize what really is important is doing what makes you happy. And I don't mean that you should just be, you know, sitting in a hammock and drinking a six-pack of beer all day, although I guess some people do that. No, but you know, doing what you want to in life, what excites you every day when you get up in the morning, and it often doesn't have that much to do with how much money you're making or how you're progressing in your company or what people think of you or what kind of awards you win, any of that. I think now that I'm older, those things are not all that meaningful to me. I look back and I say, did I do what I wanted to do? And I think for the most part, I was very lucky. I think I did have careers that I enjoyed, with one exception. And that was the career in which I made the most money, and I did not like it. So, you know, I think there's a lot to be said for that. I would advise younger people to step back and say, and I think, you know, what's really interesting here is during this pandemic, I think a lot of people have stepped back mm-hmm. and said, you know, I don't really like what I'm doing for a living. I might want to try something else. I might want to start a business. I might want to do a lot of other things. But I think that has been very helpful to take that time and look at what we want to do. And I'm hoping that a lot of young people are going with their gut on that. Yeah. You may just want to rethink what you're doing, because this is, you know, life is finite. And the older you get, the more you really see that it is finite. So let's make the most of it.
You know, it's interesting because a couple things, because I think I had a perception too of age. Like I said, I'm mid 30s. First of all, when I was younger, you know, my mom was married, 3 kids, and I was like, oh my, like, I'm not there. You know what I mean? Like, thinking that was old because she was a parent, you know, and how young she was and how I don't feel that. And then thinking, okay, you know, people in their 60s or 70s, again, what we have society tell us. And I have very good friends that are in their 60s. They're my parents' age. And they're inspiring to me because they live their life and they're out dancing and they're doing things they love and they don't care. And they just have this sense of confidence and beauty and ease. That one of them was funny because she was like, you know, she's in her 60s and she's like, yeah, I didn't want to wear a fanny pack and go on a bus. Like, she was like, that's not the image I want.
No.
And, you know, it's kind of funny. And then I had where I used to work at a fitness center, and I taught the Silver Sneakers program, and it was mostly people 60 to 90 years old, but this was like an active group. And these people, it was their third life. I mean, they were in the best shape of their life, exercising a ton, traveling, volunteering. They were like, oh, I'm more busy than when I was working. And to me, it became very inspiring to say, oh, it doesn't have to be terrible. It doesn't have to be, you know, this societal kind of pressure of, oh, I don't look as good. I don't, whatever. You know, obviously there are different people and different lifestyles, but for me, that's been inspiring. Was there any type of inspiration for you that you saw on your way to kind of the age that you're at now, or things that you do now? Which, first of all, let me just say, you have beautiful skin. As I'm looking at you, I'm like, oh, I'm like, I don't know what she's doing. Maybe it's the happiness, the exercise.
Well, that's so interesting. You know, I don't know either. And I haven't had any work done because I'm kind of against that in a way. Yeah. I'm more curious about how I'm going to age. I'm 73.
You do not look it at all. Yeah.
Well, and part of my own philosophy and what I've been studying is that people age differently. people, it's interesting, there is a gerontologist who is a professor of gerontology at UC San Francisco. Her name's Louise Aronson, and she wrote a wonderful book about aging. One of the things she says in her book is that, and she's talking about her patients, she says, when I've seen one 80-year-old, I've seen one 80-year-old. They're not all the same. They're very different. They age differently. And there are a lot of reasons for it. It isn't just, oh, you've taken good care of yourself. I mean, I'd like to think I have. I do. I exercise a lot. I probably weigh about what I did when I was your age. But I also have genes that are pretty good. I have a lot of longevity in my family, and my skin is very moist. I'm always blotting it off because there's always all
this it's working moisture. For you, Kathleen.
I hated it when I was young because sometimes it would break out, and I used to think, oh my gosh, I'd give anything not to have oily skin. Well, I take that back. I'm glad I have it.
Yes.
So, but I, yeah, you were, pardon me, you were asking about whether or not there were some people that I.
Yeah. Was there anyone that you felt kind of inspired you that was older than you to say like, oh, like, yeah, life can be different?
Well, you know, I think my aunt Mimi, who lived to be 100, and she got a college degree in the 1920s and got a master's degree, but ended up marrying her childhood sweetheart and lived on a farm. And I admired her ability to do so many things. I mean, she was a Spanish teacher in high school, but she also had this gorgeous garden, and she could can and she could cook. And one time I called her when she was in her 80s, and my uncle answered the phone, and he said, well, your Aunt Mimi's out, you know, cross country skiing in the back. And she was like 85. She kind of wasn't, she didn't fit the mold of someone born in 1908. She didn't buy into it. She wanted a college education. She wanted a master's degree. She wanted to work. But she also loved that bucolic lifestyle, being on a farm, and that, you know, that sort of the timelessness of looking out of your back door and hearing a tractor several miles away and just seeing land. And it was so peaceful. And I thought, no, that may be one reason why she lived such a long time. But I love the fact that she grew old in a way that she kind of wrote her own playbook. It was not about what society wanted. And the interesting thing is, I think she got prettier as she aged. She had this little sparkle, and there's something about an older face that I love. It's accessible. You can get in there. It's not pretentious. And she had that. So I miss her.
I love that. Yeah, I think it's always interesting because as women, we always talk about this idea of, you know, sexiness. And, you know, being attractive in that way. And do we lose that as we get older? And I always say, to me, sexiness is a confidence. And I'm a dancer. And I've seen women in their 60s, 70s, and 80s that dance with ease and beauty. And I'm like, they're embodying a sexiness and a beauty because of just the way they move and that confidence versus someone who maybe, like you said, is like overdoing it and, you know, kind of a fakeness and not being themselves. And it's just kind of interesting, I think, as we get older. I mean, I see it with myself from 10 years ago, but I see it definitely as everyone gets older, that we just kind of care less about everyone else and everything else. And like you said, kind of focus a little bit more on just enjoying our time, which seems to just automatically happen, it seems, as we age. Would you say that?
Yes. Studies show that older people are happier than younger people. They really are. And it doesn't matter if they have disabilities or if they have a chronic disease or even if they have financial problems. It seems that older people are more sanguine about life itself. Yeah. Well, I've lived these years. I know kind of what goes on. I know what to expect. And I also think there's a resilience there too that we all have and we all build upon it. But the older we get, the more experiences we've had. We've had experiences being successful and not so successful. We've made mistakes. And that's another thing I would tell young people. Don't worry if you make a mistake. This is life. Life is not this endless, you know, kind of going up and reaching for the stars and nothing goes wrong. And yeah, there are a lot of bumps. And it's from those bumps that you are able to gather resilience. So that's one reason. Another reason why older people, I think, are happier. And I think, too, that you can engender more happiness in your life by being grateful. I know we've heard this before, like, you're supposed to be grateful about everything. And sometimes it's hard. You think, well, I don't feel very grateful. I just lost my job or you know, I'm getting evicted from my apartment because I haven't paid my rent in 6 months. Or there can be a number of reasons why you're not grateful. But I think just being grateful for being alive is something that we need to kind of circle back and try to remember as much as we can. I know the older I get, the more I'm so grateful that I haven't really been sick, that, you know, I don't have any chronic issues, that I have love in my life. I have a wonderful family. It's a tiny little family because I was an only child. And my son is an only child, and my husband's an only child. So it's an itty bitty family. But, you know, I also have not a lot, but I have several really, really good friends who would be there for me, and I would be there for them. So I'm enormously grateful for all the things I've had and for what lies ahead.
So it sounds like that it's not just obviously physical components, you know, exercising, not drinking, not doing drugs, things of that nature, but it
I drink a cocktail every night. And, you know, I'm 73, and if I want to, I will. So that's just how I feel.
Yes, Kathleen, I love it. But is it where, you know, because it sounds like though that you're saying a lot of this is mindset, you know, of what, I don't know if you want to say positive thinking or just kind of, I don't know what word you want to use, but sometimes you think of like the old, like crotchety man, get off my lawn, you know, type of stereotype that's out there. And there are some people like that. If people tend to be a more negative person, is that something that they tend to stick with, or are there ways that they can kind of adjust the mindset as long as they're open to it, or any tips on that?
I think you can adjust it, but I have seen it myself. I think people, and sometimes negativity comes from a background where maybe you weren't valued. Mm-hmm. And so it's hard when you don't feel valued or you don't value yourself to have that feeling toward others. As far as get off my lawn, you know, I am much more outspoken now than I used to be. Now, I don't have a lawn because I live in a building. But I have been known, when I am on this little path that has bikes on it and pedestrians, if somebody whizzes around me on a bike and kind of carelessly, I shout after him, "Slow down." Now, I never would have done that when I was your age. I would have thought, oh my gosh, I can't do that. Well, yes, I can. I'm an older person, and you need to respect that I'm on this path, and you need to be aware of me and give me some room. And you don't just speed by like I'm not important. I am important. So
yes. Oh, I love it. I think we all need to embody that confidence and that strength. And I think, you know, one of the things, again, tends to be more women here is that when we are that way, we hear like, oh, you're difficult, you're too strong, which is ridiculous because, you know, we, like you said, you're just saying what you want to say. You're not trying to hurt anyone. You're coming from a place of just confidence, I think.
Yeah. And I think it's okay to tell younger people to, you know, watch what you're doing or consider other people. Where else are they going to hear this? This is part of the role of an elder. In other cultures, if somebody was speeding around a little old lady, which I consider myself, even though I'm 5'9", I'm a little shorter than I used to be. And I'm certainly older, but if someone were doing that, and the little old lady said, "Slow down," that person would probably stop and say, "I'm sorry, I didn't mean to frighten you. You're right. I need to slow down." There's a respect that is missing in our culture. We do not value older people. And I got to tell all the people watching here and listening, you're all going to get old and you're going to want respect. So now is the time to learn to respect people who are older than you so you can get it back when you're my age.
Yes, karma.
Yes.
It is. And it, I agree with you. You know, I think even what you're talking about is so much based on the U.S. My boyfriend's from Egypt, and he talks all the time, talking about an older culture. Like, he always says, whoever's the oldest in the room is in charge. And sometimes that's frustrating because maybe they're not a great person. But it's always about respecting that age and that they have that wisdom and leadership and that sort of thing. So it totally makes sense. Now, you have a new book out. Can you tell us the name of it and, you know, how it kind of fits into everything we're talking about?
Yes, I'd be delighted to tell you. Yeah, the book is called Reclaim Your Right to Grow Old. And the subtitle is How to Immerse Yourself in, Be Curious About, and Celebrate Life's Most Important Stage.
It's so good. And you talk a lot about, again, you teach at various universities, so you're pulling in a lot of history, a lot of personal stuff as well. If people want to connect with you or they want to read the book, where can they do that?
Well, I do have a website, growoldbehappy.com, all one word. You can order the book there. You can read my blogs. You can read about my philosophy and all the other things that I've been doing to promote this philosophy. You can also go to Amazon, of course, Kathleen O'Brien, Reclaim Your Right to Grow Old, and Barnes & Noble, and Outskirts Press, which is my publisher, also has the book available.
Perfect. And the last question I like to ask all my guests, Kathleen, is what is one word or quote or mantra that you try to live by every single day?
The one word I try to live by every day, and I hope I embody it a little bit, is enthusiasm. I think it's really important to be enthusiastic about life, about who we are, about just being here on this gorgeous earth that we're so fortunate to be a part of. So yes, enthusiasm is a word that's important to me.
I love it. Well, thank you so much. I was going to say, I appreciate your enthusiasm, your confidence, your honesty, your excitement for who you are and about life and kind of sharing this message. So I thank you so much for being here. And I look forward to hearing more.
Oh, Carrie, it's been my pleasure. Thank you.